Susan Lindauer, the book Extreme Prejudice. Susan, we left the break. You were sitting in a prison. Tell us the rest of your story. We have one segment left, ma'am.
I was locked in prison on Carswell Air Force Base. It is a regular prison where they're locking up women dissidents and intellectuals. There was another woman there who published an article in a newspaper. And they said that the article was threatening. It was not advocating violence. I saw it. It did not advocate violence, but it did say that George Bush should not be president, and that he should be impeached. And questioning him, it was a free speech tirade against George Bush. But they had printed it. It was not advocating violence or advocating the assassination of the president. No way. She got 4 years.
Wow.
Okay, 4 years for this that she had served, and they were denying her the right to a trial as well. This is how they're doing it now, because they are punishing you outside of the law. You see, they're using the judicial system, but they can't defend it in front of a jury. So they are resorting to they have to create a different strategy. And it is important to know that sedition, again, I have to say this again and again, terrorism now includes ordinary sedition, ordinary acts of free speech. The answer is not to give up your speech. You've got to maintain a high profile. They've got to know that we the people are now uniting and standing together and pulling together as a community, and that we're going to defend each other. When I was taken, I was taken in 2004, and the internet was at a very different stage of development at that phase. The people relied on the corporate media, CNN, Fox News, and whatever those CNN censored, whatever they chose to cover at a very superficial level. You might get you wouldn't have a 2-hour interview with somebody like me. You'd have a 5-second soundbite, and then the story would go on to something else. So you didn't get to cover things at this kind of depth. 9/11 was known in advance. They were hiding it. In my situation, the FBI and the U.S. Attorney's Office and the Bureau of Prisons all verified my 9/11 story and warnings, the advance warnings we gave about 9/11. They each verified them independently, separate from one another. And each one of them turned around and lied to a federal judge about the 9/11 warnings. They tried to hold, the government petitioned for the right to detain me indefinitely with no trial for up to 10 years. You can't even imagine what this felt like. They ordered me to surrender to prison, and I was supposed to go in for 4 months originally, but once they got me into prison, they refused to let me go. And that is very scary. That is the most terrifying thing in the world, is when they say, "Huh, we changed our mind. Now you've cooperated with us. Now we've got you trapped in the prison. You're not going anywhere."
And they've given themselves the right to do this. That's the thing that absolutely floors me. It's not like the people said, "Hey, we want to be under tyrannical control." They've given themselves the right to do this and then created enough darkness and shadow to keep their actions hidden. So paint a picture for us. What does the future look like for the rest of us if this continues?
We are heading into a state where martial law could easily be applied to the people of the United States. And those people who create problems, and it could be, you know, your kid, your teenager, your college student who goes to an Occupy Wall Street rally and becomes an activist, that those would be the people who they're going to take. I do fear that we should expect another false flag terrorist attack. I expect that because they succeeded in Iraq, pulling the United States into war, that we will see a miniature thermonuclear attack, a dirty suitcase bomb, on the financial district of Wall Street. And at that point, all these laws that are in place, the Patriot Act, the NDAA, will suddenly be implemented in full, and all of the regular freedom that we still possess or that we think we possess will suddenly be stripped away. The internet will be censored overnight, and they will be shutting down anybody who speaks against America, who speaks against the authority, the institutions, the economic institutions, the 1% which control the military, the banks, the financial institutions, the corporations. The law exists to protect their power against the people. But the 99% of us, including those of us who used to be in the middle class, we will be politically disenfranchised. And the case of, I got to tell you this one last story before we go, because this is relates to the NDAA. Because I was held at a military base, my uncle, who was an attorney, who tried to, wonderful man, brilliant, I loved him, beloved uncle, tremendous hero of mine, tried to save me. He visited me three times, and twice, the first two times, the military refused to grant him access to me as a prisoner, even though he was a family member and an attorney. They categorically said, there is no prison on Carswell Air Force Base. And this woman you're talking about, this Susan Lindauer, she is not here. My uncle said, well, you're wrong. May I please speak with your commanding officer on duty? Because I have I can prove she's here. I have letters mailed from your base, and I have a judge's order for her surrender to your base, so I can show you right now that she's here. They said, it doesn't matter. She is not here, and there is no prison. You are not coming onto our base. Now, my uncle drove 700 miles in each direction, and he was not playing any games. He tried very hard to get onto that base. It's a 1,400-mile round trip, and he said, I assure you, there's no way I would have driven 1,400 miles round trip if I wasn't positive she was here. You're wrong. They said, it doesn't matter. We decide who comes onto our base, and you're not coming in. She's on the Patriot Act. You're not coming in. The second time, they said the second time he drove down to see me, the government, the military said, oh, there is a prison on the base, but they don't have visiting hours on the weekend. Meanwhile, other family members were standing there waiting to come onto the base to visit other prisoners. Each one of them was allowed to come into the prison around him. And he's like, but they're going into the base. That person's going in. That person's going in. Once again, they called the commanding officer. The commanding officer said, oh, no. There's no visiting hours for you on this base on a Saturday or a Sunday. Oh, no, no, no. He said, well, I'm going to file a complaint with the judge. Now, here is where the NDAA versus the Patriot Act becomes very important. When they refused to let me have access to an attorney visit, because, my uncle was functioning. He was not only a family member. He was functioning as my attorney, trying to get me the heck out of there. He was trying to save me and to rescue me from this situation. So he was applying. He had filed paperwork, adding himself to my legal team. He was part of my legal team. And they said, well, I don't care. You're not going to have an attorney visit. This is a military base. We decide who comes onto our military base, and you ain't coming in. It took a third visit with the U.S. Marshals flanking my uncle, and attorney, to force the U.S. military to allow this attorney visit to occur. And my judge was sitting in his office waiting for the U.S. Marshals to call so that they could force the U.S. military to allow an attorney visit to occur. And I want you to realize this NDAA stuff is deadly, because the only thing about the Patriot Act that's good is there's still a judge that you can appeal to if the military plays games.
And the NDAA takes that judge away, correct? My plan was initially to end this show today with a clip from Andrew Breitbart, because he passed away today. And we're not going to do that. It's not because we shouldn't pay a little tribute to somebody who I met a year ago and who has done a lot for journalism, both on the right and the left. It's because as a journalist, he would want us to continue to pursue the news and the relevant topics, and that's what we're going to do. So, Susan, we're going to keep you on for the last segment of the show, and I would like to, if possible, take a couple callers. Let's go first to Anna in Iowa. Anna, welcome to the show.
Hi, Josh. Hi, Susan. Thanks for taking my call. Wow, Susan, what a story. My question is for you, Susan. With your work in the intelligence industry, are you aware of the historical significance of 9/11?
Oh, yeah. I mean, yes, yes, definitely. I don't want to overwhelm people with that because I'm concerned that the 9/11 truth community, we don't want to alienate anybody. I'm very worried that we're going to see another attack occurring very soon because we succeeded, not we. The tragedy of 9/11 is that it succeeded in its goal. It manipulated the American people and it pushed us into a war that we never should have fought, which was the Iraq War. And I'm very afraid that they will use another false flag operation to push us into war with Iran. And because we have failed to learn the lessons of 9/11, because most of the people don't understand that 9/11 manipulated the public, we're in danger. We're in grave danger of having a second attack.
Thinking about other 9/11s, like the Chilean coup in 9/11, the Metal Mountain Massacre in 9/11.
I'm sorry, the what?
There was a Metal Mountain Massacre. It was like in 1847 where a bunch of Mormons attacked a bunch of Baptists and blamed it on the Indians. And when we attacked Chile, that was also on September 11th. And the groundbreaking for the Pentagon.
I did not think of that. I'm sorry. No. Tell us more.
The groundbreaking for the Pentagon was on 9/11, and when they picked the numbers for our emergency response, they could have picked any number, and most people had dial phones then, and they picked 9/11.
So, Susan, you're saying there's some significance with the number?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of significance with the number and a history of false flags with the number.
Okay.
Very interesting. I'm going to have to look into that because I really don't know.
I was not aware of that. I was not aware of that. Thank you very much for that information.
Or Anna, yeah.
I was thinking of the historical significance of the fact that we're in danger of having this happen to us again. And I believe it's imminent because we're being pushed by Israel, unfortunately, to go into war with Iran. And the crisis in Syria is creating more tension and pressure on the United States government. I do believe that we should stay out of these wars. I have a very strong opinions about this matter, that we are hurting our middle class. We cannot afford to fight any more wars. We're hurting our military. We need our brave soldiers, our good soldiers, to come home and reintegrate with their families and come back into the community. I support the military, and I admire the military. But we are exhausting them, and we need to give them a break. So I'm afraid
thank you for
that
the
we're
call,
going
Anna.
To be pushed by another 9/11 attack into a war that will cause even more harm to America.
Yeah, that would be terrible. Steve in Illinois, what say you, sir?
Oh, thank God I got on. The last caller is starting to get off track like they always do. I'm going to have to hold many things I could tell you in abeyance because there is a documentary out that you owe it to yourself, guest and host, to partake of. And it's called The Shock Doctrine. And it's an oh my God expose of what has taken place since Eisenhower gave us the warning of the military industrial complex. To what's going on right now, and you asked a pointed question before the last break, Josh, what is going to happen? It's in there, and it is terribly important that people see this. Sundance had it on. I saw it 2 years ago, but it includes everything, Susan, that you've been talking about and more, and I want to tell people, get close to your God because what's going on in this country, but this documentary, The Shock Doctrine is an absolute must-see, and I just hope that you will do it, Josh, and I'm glad I got on to say it because it is scary what is happening.
Well, thank you, Steve. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Steve. I'm writing that down too. That sounds like something I want to see.
Yeah, I'm gonna watch it this weekend myself. So thank you, Steve. All right, Susan. So we're coming.
We're past the point where this stuff is not conspiracy. You know,
right.
The things I'm telling you today are not conspiracy. I engage directly in these events myself. I am not telling you what somebody else did. I'm telling you what I did. I'm telling you my direct knowledge of these events. And, for example, unfortunately, the 9/11 truth community has polarized some of this debate, and I hope that there's some people out there who will reconsider their hostility to these questions, and they will stop being afraid of these questions, because really, those who do not learn from history are doomed to repeat it, and that is
well.
What's
and I
happening.
Think that's the important
we
message.
We are allowing this myth. 9/11 is a myth that we've created that is taking our freedom away. Those terrorists, Josh, you were totally right. Terrorists are winning because we're giving up the best part of America. And we have right now a 2012 election coming. We have got to take back our country immediately. There are few moments where you can actually make a difference. And this coming year is pivotal. And so I urge everybody, even if you don't like 9/11, you think, oh, God, it's 10 years ago already, realize that the impact is very much, it's a shadow over everyone. And if you allow it to become this great, big, huge, monstrous shadow, it's going to continue to destroy what's good about this country. So you have
well,
to
that's
know
exactly
so
why
can,
we had you on today,
you
Susan, because I wanted to take that opportunity and kind of break away some of the mystery, the mystique behind this. Whenever somebody brings up, oh, you know, we have to fight the Patriot Act, we have to fight for freedom, it always comes back to, oh, you must be a 9/11 truther. And to make that link is totally irrelevant, regardless of what your thought is about 9/11. Like I said before, whether you think there are questions or whether you're buying the story, it doesn't really matter. In the grand scope of moving forward, we still have to deal with the ramifications of whatever it was that happened. It happened. Now, what are we dealing with because of it? And what we're dealing with is a lack of freedom on all fronts, an America that is essentially dead at its core, because America is the people. It's not the borders that it makes up. It's the people that are in those borders. And when those people lose their freedom, the country itself no longer exists.
Exactly. Beautifully said.
Well, thank you so much.
Beautifully said. That's right. And this is the most beautiful country on the earth. I mean, we've got our flaws. We're not perfect. I realize that. People say, but we killed the Indians. We stole the land. We did all these things. We had slavery. Our founding fathers owned slaves. They didn't really believe in freedom. The Constitution, you never realize how precious this Constitution and the Bill of Rights is until you have a government take every single thing away from you. I rediscovered my love of the Constitution through 5 years of indictment on the Patriot Act. And I came to see why every one of those principles must be cherished and defended. And it wasn't because of 9/11. It was because they took away my right to freedom of speech, and they tried to intimidate me into not talking, and they silenced me, and they gagged me, and they locked me in prison. And they said that the idea of oppose, in my case, it wasn't, they were hiding the 9/11 facts, yes. But the way that they did it was to say that opposition to war, they attacked me, the principle that they invoked to get me in prison was that I had opposed the Iraqi war.
Well, Susan, we are up at the end of the show. I thank you so much. I thank you so much for joining us today. It was definitely eye-opening and a very interesting story, especially with somebody from your perspective as a CIA asset. And you mentioned the Constitution. The wonderful thing about the Constitution is, yes, we were not perfect. We have done bad things as a nation. But because we are a constitutional republic, it allows us the opportunity to learn from our mistakes, repent, and move ahead as a nation, as a people, with a common goal and interest. And folks, I have to tell you, the common goal and interest now has to be our freedom. So today, tomorrow, and as always, may your path lead to heaven. May freedom follow in your footsteps. And rest in peace, Andrew Breitbart. Oh, yeah.